Thanks to you, the hardcore, for showing up for day three. Just a reminder about the lecture notes. The lecture notes are mostly done. They need a little polishing, small typos and things like that. So I'll probably post a revised version in the next couple of weeks. They're available on the archive. If you don't copy this down, if you just go to the archive.org and search for my name, you will find it. All right. So the topic for today is relative humidity. And you may have heard that it's sort of expected to be constant. Well, what does that even mean, right? Relative humidity is kind of varies in the vertical throughout the atmosphere, so is it going to be, it's not even constant in the vertical, right? So if I change the climate, is it constant at a fixed height, or at a fixed temperature, or at a fixed pressure, or? So what does this mean? Is it exactly true, approximately true? And if so, why? So those are the questions we want to answer today. Why do we care about relative humidity? Well, first of all, it's a very tangible variable, right? We all experience relative humidity every day. And as we showed last time, right, the water vapor feedback and the treatment that we gave it last time sort of depended on relative humidity not varying very much. And if it did, it would have implications for the water vapor feedback and hence for climate sensitivity. So that's a big motivation for why we care about relative humidity. So we want to know what the physics is of relative humidity, but as soon as we start to really think about it, the problem sort of bifurcates. So why is that? So we'll consider our idealized box, where the world is, we think of as being made up of the atmosphere over a tropical ocean. Right? We focus on the tropics, because that's half of Earth's surface area. We focus on the ocean, because that's the what composes most of that surface. So we've got our ocean here. And then we have this atmospheric boundary layer, the VL. And that's the slower kilometer or so of atmosphere that's in direct contact with the surface. And any moisture that's evaporated goes straight into here, but doesn't really penetrate directly into here. For that, you need convection. I'm going to bring this up, and then you get clouds. And so that means that, you know, the physics of relative humidity is different between these two areas because their source of moisture is different, right? The boundary layer is moistened directly by the ocean surface, but in this part of the atmosphere, and by the way, this whole part of the atmosphere referred to as the troposphere. This is where all the weather is happening, the convection and storms, and all the latent heating. And this part of the troposphere, apart from the boundary layer, is known as the free troposphere. I've never seen anyone explain why it's called the free troposphere, but maybe it's because it's not sort of slaved to the surface the way the boundary layer is. Right? That's just my guess. Alright, so the first thing we can see just from this cartoon is that the physics of RH is different in the free troposphere, called VFT. The boundary layer. So we're going to have to split this problem up into pieces. And so the lecture today will be in two parts, one on each. And so we'll start with the boundary layer. So relative humidity, subscript VL. All right. Now my claim is that, so we want to know what determines this guy and what determines how it changes with warming. And my claim is that relative humidity in the boundary layer is governed by evaporation E, evaporation, or sort of closely connected to it. That's a connection that I'll explain. And the reason this connection is important is because evaporation is closely tied to precipitation, right? Evaporation is the amount of water that goes into the atmosphere, precipitation is the amount of water coming out of the atmosphere, and in a steady state, the total amount of water in the atmosphere is not changing. So these guys have to be equal. So this connection is just that E equals P. But as we discussed last time, the condensation heating from precipitation balances radiative cooling in the atmosphere. And so this guy is linked to Q via this equation which we had yesterday, which just expresses the energy balance of the atmosphere. Right? The radiated cooling of the atmosphere is balanced by condensation heating from precipitation. And the reason I've drawn this chain here is because yesterday's lecture was all about understanding how these things change with global warming. This is the column integrated cooling. These three guys are all in units of watts per meter squared. And so we know how this changes, right? Roughly 2% per Kelvin. And I gave an interpretation for this in terms of the depth of the atmosphere, which is increasing by 1% per Kelvin when you measure it in temperature coordinates. So these guys will then all have to increase to 2% per Kelvin, and that will tell us how this is going to change. So now we're just going to work through that math. The first thing we need is a mathematical form for this relationship. And I'm going to write it down and then explain it. And so the connection between evaporation and relative humidity in the boundary layer is given by so-called bulk aerodynamic formula and so I'll write it down and then explain it. So evaporation rate is given by the symbol CD times U times rho V star. So remember, rho V was the density of water vapor in kilograms per meter cubed. Star means it takes on its saturation value. That saturation value is a function of temperature. And I have rho V star at TS minus rho V at some typical boundary layer height, which is often taken to be 2 meters. And that's the expression. So let's interpret it. So if I think about the ocean surface, there's a thin viscous layer of air, maybe a millimeter thick, kind of riding on top of it. And that layer of air has the same temperature as the ocean underneath it, and it's saturated. So it has this vapor density. This is the vapor density of kind of more generic air that's just kind of flowing around the boundary layer. So what this is, you should think of this as a air C moisture gradient. It's really a finite difference, but that's how you should think about it. And of course, the units are kilograms per meter cubed. So that's your air C moisture differential. And what's happening is that turbulence in the boundary layer is mixing up this air that's really close to the surface that's saturated with just your run of the mill boundary layer air, and it's moistening it. So, and it's acting as a kind of turbulent diffusivity, fluxing moisture from the surface into the boundary layer. And this turbulence is found to be proportional to the horizontal wind speed near the surface. So that's in meters per second. As well as a drag coefficient that's dimensionless. Which measures how rough the surface is and kind of it's a measure of how much turbulence you're getting. And if you put these units together, it gives you an evaporation in units of kilograms per meter, kilograms of water per meter squared per second. So this is an expression for the evaporation rate. And expressions like this are used in models, right, and have been verified on the mission. Any questions about this expression? Yes.
What was TS again?
Surface temperature.
Oh, okay.
Thank you. Always good to know what the symbols on the board mean.
And rho V is?
Vapor density. So that's in kilograms of water per meter cubed. Water vapor.
So maybe I'm misunderstanding, but yes. You have one term that's rho V times 2 meters.
No, rho V evaluated at 2 meters.
Oh, yeah.
So rho V divided Z equals 2 meters. Good. Glad to answer these questions. Someone in the back?
I was just curious about the reference height of 2 meters. You know, how you establish that this provides the sort of suitable gradient term as opposed to any other value, and how sensitive is it to choosing a different value?
It shouldn't, so you basically, you don't want it too close to the surface such that you're anywhere close to the skin layer that's like a millimeter thick, right? And you don't want to evaluate this at, you know, a few hundred meters. Well, A, that's hard, so 2 meters is easy to evaluate, right? And you don't want to evaluate too high because then you might be above the top of the boundary layer if the boundary layer is really shallow, right? Because the boundary layer height can vary depending on the amount of turbulence. So this is, I don't really know, but I'm guessing this is just a convenient height at which to sort of put your sensors and measure things. Other questions? Uh-oh.
So very quickly on it, I mean, it doesn't really matter. It's a convention. You need a reference point. And so ultimately, you have the turbulent fluxes and you relate it to basically potential difference. But you can formulate it in terms of the 2 meter or the lowest model level, but then kind of your prefactor, the C, is looking a little bit different.
Right. But the idea is just that the boundary layer turbulence in here is kind of mixing things up. And so quantities like rho v, you don't expect to vary too much within the boundary layer. All right. So now we're going to simplify this a little bit. Let's see. Here. So what are we going to do? So we'll make some approximations. We'll assume that the air temperature at 2 meters is roughly the same as the surface temperature. That's not quite true. The surface is a little warmer, but typically the surface is order 1 Kelvin. So what else do we do? So if this is true, then the saturation vapor density at Z equals 2 meters, but this is just a function of temperature, and that's what we talked about last time, and it's basically given by this Clausius-Clapeyron function. This should be the same thing as the saturation vapor density at the surface temperature. Right? So I'm saying the temperatures there are pretty much the same. But if that's the case, I can write this as a relative humidity in the boundary layer times rho v star of Ts. And I can factor the rho v star of Ts outside of this expression. So this is a pretty simple expression that we can work with. So now what we'll do is we'll just take its logarithmic derivative. Now it turns out that sort of robustly across models, you don't see big changes in CD and U with climate change. So variations in this guy don't really play much of a role. There's references for this in the notes. So we're going to neglect changes with in these guys with surface temperature. So what we really have are these two contributions. We have the logarithmic derivative in vapor density. And then I take a logarithmic derivative of this, which ends up looking like that, right? Just using the chain rule there. And I remember that this is the same thing as d log p dTs, right? I said over here I was going to use that. And so now I'm just going to rearrange. What we're interested in is this guy. So I'll just move him to the other side, move the d log e dTs to that side, and multiply through by this. So I get my d log rho v star dTs minus d log p dTs. And the whole thing is multiplied by 1 minus rh. Now we're just going to evaluate this. And actually, a really fun part of the calculation is evaluating this. Because it's easy. So remember, call that rho p star of ts proportional to this exponential, right? This is this Clausius-Clapeyron expression. And so it's easy to take a logarithmic derivative of that. Right? The log is just the exponent, differentiate, I get a minus sign and a ts squared on the bottom. And if you plug in numbers, and this is a fun thing to do on your own, you get 6% per Kelvin. Maybe 7% per Kelvin. Depending on exactly what surface temperature you put in. And so this is what's referred to as Clausius-Clapeyron scaling, CC scaling. And so when people talk about, oh, with global warming, you expect the atmosphere is going to get warmer and it's going to hold more moisture. And the moisture content of the atmosphere increases at 6% per Kelvin. This is where that number comes from. And it's just a combination of fundamental constants and the surface temperature. It actually varies a little bit with surface temperature, right? In different climates, you get a different scaling. It's not always 6% per Kelvin. But this is a fun thing to see explicitly, because it's a number you hear kind of batted around a lot. Okay, so that's one of our terms, right? So 0.06 Kelvin inverse. When we talked yesterday about how this was about 2% for Kelvin, so 0.2 Kelvin inverse. And then a typical Badgley relative humidity in the tropics is maybe 75%, thereabouts. So just for nice even numbers, I'll take 1 minus 3 quarters, that could be 1 quarter. This gives me 0.04 Kelvin divided by 4, 0.01 Kelvin inverse. So this is an estimate of how boundary layer relative humidity is changing with climate. And it's governed by the physics here, by the fact that how moist the boundary layer is, the boundary layer has to be exactly, or has to be as moist as it needs to be to get the right amount of evaporation off the ocean surface, such that you get the amount of precipitation you need to balance the atmosphere's energy budget. And that's what this chain of logic is telling you. There's an energy budget constraint, you have to get a certain amount of evaporation, and that sets the relative humidity of the boundary layer. So if the boundary layer is too moist, you don't get enough evaporation. If it's too dry, you get too much evaporation. And just that logic leads to this. So it's not totally constant, but this is a small number, right? If I double CO2 and I get 3.5 Kelvins worth of warming, then that's going to raise my relative humidity from 75% to 78%. Man, small change, small effect. It washes up in noise. So at least in terms of boundary layer relative humidity, this is one justification for why you can imagine it as being constant. Right? Not quite true, but the changes are negligible. But you actually expect an increase, and this is what you observe in simulation. What you find in simulation.
Are there actual observed changes in relative humidity?
So there is a whole literature on that. I'm not an expert on it. And people also look at precipitation. We don't have great records, we don't have observations, we don't have them for long enough to untangle the effects from internal variability, from aerosols. So my impression from looking at that literature is that it's just hard to say much about long-term trends that are really a function of climate, or of surface temperature changes or anthropogenic. Yes?
I have a question. So the rho V is at 2 meters
yes.
in the boundary, and the relative humidity should be also at 2 meters, right?
That's right.
But the boundary is kind of not just 2 meters. It's like 1,000 meters, the relative humidity change from surface to cover.
It does, that's right. In fact, if you consider a sort of convecting parcel, right, its relative
yes.
humidity will start out at the surface volume, and as you raise it up, it's getting closer and closer to saturation.
Yeah.
And that cloud base at the top of the boundary will actually become one. So he's raising a good point. that basically there's some variables that don't change much as you move air up and down the boundary layer as turbulence sort of buffets air parcels around. There's other variables that do change. And so it turns out that you don't expect rho v to change very much. It's not perfectly conserved, but its variations are small. But relative humidity does have a gradient in the boundary layer just from adiabatic displacement. That if you start out with 75% relative humidity here, as you raise your air parcel up, it cools and it approaches saturation. So I really am talking about the near surface value of relative humidity, which is both what we experience, right, and what's governing the evaporative flux. That's a good point. Yes?
Does this constraint make sense at all over land?
No. And so, in fact, if you look at simulations, you find a land-ocean contrast in changes in relative humidity. And I think you find that relative humidity over land goes down. And that's sort of still an area of effective research. And there are people out there who will understand that better than me. I don't know if it's totally settled,
yeah,
but there's some ideas about making sense.
Yeah.
Is that also from the observation that there's a...
that the land is drying?
Yeah.
That's a really great question. I don't know. Stefan or Gabe might know.
I mean, I guess it makes some intuitive sense in that the land is more constrained in how much evaporation.
Exactly.
Than the surface temperatures.
That's right. And, I mean, if it were swapped and if land was 2/3 of the surface area and ocean was only 1/3, right?
Yeah.
Then you couldn't use an argument like this, because the evaporative fluxes might be dominated by land and you have to take into account moisture availability. And one thing I've done here is I've assumed that making this connection, I'm assuming that most of the energy that the atmosphere gets from the surface is in the form of water vapor as opposed to just direct heating by a warm surface. But if you had a mostly land-covered planet, you wouldn't expect such a balance.
Right. Okay.
So there's assumptions baked in here that kind of you're already in a water-covered, water-dominated planet.
Right.
All right. So let's move on then to the free troposphere, and maybe I will. Relative humidity in the free troposphere. So what is the physics of relative humidity in the free troposphere? So I said that the source of moisture up here was convection. That's what's bringing moist boundary layer air, where that moisture really came from the ocean, up to the rest of the atmosphere. But if these clouds just came up, condensed out all their water vapor, and then dropped it back to the ocean as precipitation, that wouldn't moisten the atmosphere at all. Right? But we know that's not what clouds do. Certainly not all clouds, right? Most clouds are fair weather clouds. Right? I mean, I'm from California, so I think all clouds are fair weather clouds. And there, a white cloud pops up, it's puffy, and then half an hour later it's gone. But it didn't precipitate at all. So really, convection brought moisture up into the free troposphere, and then there was mixing. And when you mix the saturated air with drier air, then you evaporate the cloud droplets and you moisten the free troposphere. So really, in the free troposphere, convective mixing is key. So if we're going to somehow try to model this quantitatively, we need a model for convective mixing. So that's what we're going to do on. So we'll do this in the simplest way we can. So again, consider a patch of atmosphere, finite patch, and let's just divide it into a region that's convecting and a region that's not. In reality, you'll have convective plumes bubbling up everywhere. But in your mind, you want to sort of organize all those convective plumes into one region, your convecting region. And we're imagining that all these plumes have the exact same properties. Obviously, this is a very crude approximation, but this is how we're doing it. So we have a convecting region, some plume. I'm going to need this to be bigger. Redraw this. Convecting region. And then we have the clear sky environment. convection going on. And I've got some mass flux. So I denote M of Z. And this is the convective mass flux per average area of the domain. So really, I've got some domain. I add up all the mass flux in kilograms per second that's going upwards, and then I divide by the total area of the domain. And so that has units of kilogram per meter squared per second. And the reason I do that is that if this is the average amount of flux that's going up, there has to be some compensating same amount of flux going down, right, in the clear sky. Otherwise, mass would be piling up somewhere in the atmosphere. And it's not allowed to do that. So I've got some air in the environment that's subsiding downwards and has the same area average mass flux, just in the opposite direction. Right? So there's cloudy air going up, clear air going down. But we just established that mixing is key. So this model has to, I somehow need to be exchanging mass between these two regions. Right? So it's up here. So I've got some detrainment, D, there's a profile of it, so it's a function of Z. And its units are kilogram per meter cubed per second. And this is just the average rate at which air from the convecting region is being converted to air in the environment. Really, the cloudy air is becoming clear at this rate. And then I have to have entrainment, where as clouds rise, they sort of engulf environmental air, drag them upwards until they condense, and so they become cloudy air. So entrainment, same units. All right, so this tells me how the convecting region and the environment are exchanging mass. What I'm really interested in is how they're exchanging moisture. Right? That's what we need to know about. So we need to put moisture in this model. And it'll be really convenient to use a new moisture variable. By the way, this model is usually known as a bulk plume model. The bulk just means that we're sort of imagining, really this is a stand-in for any number of convective plumes, but we imagine them to all have the same properties. So it's like one big plume in a sense. All right, so the new moisture variable I'm going to use is the specific humidity, Q, and it's just defined to be the ratio of the vapor density to the total air density. So it's unitless, or you can think of it as being kilograms per kilogram. I think I might try and color code things, so. And the reason we do this is because then, if my mass flux is m, then my moisture flux is just m times q in the cloud, whatever that value is. And then my downwards moisture flux here is just minus m times q in the environment. And similarly for the entrainment and detrainment, if I'm detraining mass, then the flux of moisture is D times Q cloud. And if I'm entraining, then the moisture that I'm entraining into the cloud is just E times Q environment. So that's why I use this variable. Different than the rho V we've been. So now I can write down some equations. Let me do that over here. Any questions about the model setup so far?
Zero, detrainment and entrainment on top of the clouds is the same as a battery entrainment.
No, we don't model it separately, but there's a profile of all these guys. And so when the cloud kind of like dumps out at the top, that's just a sort of a local peak in the detrainment at large values of Z. But there's no explicit cloud top entrainment in this model.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Other questions? All right. So using this, we can write down an equation for the mass. So we'll write down the bulk plume we need to do it here. So we'll write down the bulk plume equations. So for mass, if I have a vertical derivative in m, let's say m is getting larger as I'm going up, that means I must be adding mass to the convecting region. And so this must be the difference between the mass I'm adding minus the mass I'm taking away, right? The entrainment minus the detrainment. And this has units of kilograms per meter cubed per second. The other thing I need is an equation for the environmental moisture. Because remember, I'm going to be interested in relative humidity here. Right? Because the relative humidity here is 1. This guy's saturated. So we're interested in this here, so we want an equation for the moisture here. Environmental. So there, again, I take divergence of the moisture flux in the environment. If the moisture flux is minus, oh, I'm skipping something. What I haven't done yet is tell you how the Q in the cloud and the Q in the environment and the temperature and the pressure in the cloud and the environment are related to each other. We're going to need that to describe how moisture is exchanged. So let's think about these thermodynamic variables. So let's start with temperature. It turns out that, so this cloud is buoyant, so it's got to be a bit warmer than the environment, but it's only slightly warmer, like a Kelvin or less, right? And that's enough to drive buoyant flow. Remember, clouds don't actually really move that fast, you know, a handful of meters per second. So a half Kelvin temperature difference between the cloud and the environment is sufficient to drive that. But for our purposes, that difference is negligible, right? We're not interested in the buoyant motion of the cloud. So the environmental temperature and the cloud temperature are roughly equal, and so we should denote them by T. If we consider the pressure, these guys are also equal, because any pressure differential would be equilibrated out by sound waves, right? Pressure is the same. In the cloud is saturated. And so it's going to take its saturation value. And if I look at this, right, this is Q. So its saturation value is just the saturation value of this guy. Which we saw last time was just a function of temperature. Divided by rho, but rho by the ideal gas law is a function of pressure and temperature. So this Q star has temperature and pressure dependence. The pressure dependence is not as dramatic as the temperature dependence, but it's there. And then Q in the environment, we'll just call Q. And so you can think of so the environment's got some T, Q, and P. And the convecting region has some T, Q star, and P. So the main difference, right, between the cloud and the environment is that the cloud is saturated. It has Q star. The environment just has Q. So now I want an equation for environmental moisture. If the moisture content is increasing as I go down, or decreasing, it must be because of sources and sinks, and I know what those are. So the source to the environment is detrainment times Q star, and the sink for the environment is entrainment times Q. So those are our two equations, and we're just going to work with these. Those are all the ingredients. So everything else we're going to do is just going to be manipulating these, getting an expression for relative humidity in terms of what I already have on the board. So the way we do that, so we've got these entrainment and detrainment rates. They're not the most, we'll define slightly more convenient forms. So we'll define fractional transmit slash detransmit. So epsilon, which is defined to be E divided by the mass flux, and delta, defined to be D divided by the mass flux. These have units of 1 over meter. And the interpretation is there's a length scale here, and that's the length scale over which the plume entrains amount of mass equal to itself. That's what it is. So it's a fractional entrainment length scale. And if you take these definitions, so you'll notice that here, if I use the product rule, I get a dzm, and then I can sub in this equation for dzm. So you do that, you do 4 or 5 lines of manipulation, and what you find is this equation. So this has the delta, which is the fractional detrainment. What is this telling you?
What's Q versus QB?
Oh, sorry. It should be just using. They're the same thing.
Right.
Just couldn't decide which one I was going to use. Yeah, the V would stand for vapor, but that's the only one we're talking about is vapor. So, thank you. Of course, it happens.
I thought Q was in the environment, though. Just Q by itself. So, not that. Well, yeah.
That's right. So, if it was in the cloud, it'd be Q star.
Yeah.
Right. So, there's just Q and Q star. So what is this telling you? It's telling you that as this environmental air is going downwards, right, the Q value is changing, and it's relaxing towards the value in the cloud with the length scale of 1 over delta, right? Because if the value of the environment is far from saturation, then this term will strongly bring it towards saturation. So that's what this is telling. And what's doing that is detrainment, right? Detrainment of saturated air from the cloud. That's why it's the detrainment, not the entrainment, fractional detrainment that's in here. So the environmental Q relaxes to QV star over length scale, 1 over delta. And that makes sense, right? If delta is large, that means there's a lot of detrainment, that means this length scale is small. And so you quickly, this relaxation happens quickly, and sinking air is moistened quite strongly. And we'll have a high relative humidity, as we'll see in a second. So the dependence works the right way. All right, so we still have to get an expression for relative humidity from this, but now we can kind of get it from a picture. So let's draw another one of our plumes here. And let's consider two heights. Let me redraw this. So two heights. So here I've got Q star at height Z, I'm in the cloud. So I'm saturated. The same height z, I have q. And let's let this distance be 1 over delta between these two levels. And so here I have q of z minus 1 over delta. But what this is saying, right, is that as this guy travels a length 1 over delta, it's sort of relaxing to this value. And so the Q over here should be given by the Q star up here, with this distance being given by 1 over delta. That's how we're interpreting this equation. So I write Q down here as Q star up here.
Should we think of delta as constant?
Sorry?
Should we think of delta as being a constant?
Yes. Of course, if you go into simulations and try and measure this, you know, it's not quite constant, but it actually has a characteristic value, which I'll write down in a second. And in fact, that characteristic value will tell us what relative humidity is, along with one other number that I'm going to write. Yep. All right. So what do I want to do with this? So I've got this equation, but I want to write this Q here. So I have Q star of z is Q of z minus 1 over delta. Questions?
No, I've got it.
Sure. I want to write this as the relative humidity times Q times the saturation value. That's basically the definition of relative humidity, right? That's all I did there. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to solve this for relative humidity. Get Q star over, so Q star, so this is Q star of z over, and this is relative humidity at z. Q star of z over Q star of z minus 1 over delta. And now I'm just going to Taylor expand. Star of z, this is q star of z minus dz q star. Get rid of some cloud, evaporate some cloud here. Dz of q star times 1 over delta. That was just Taylor's. And I can rewrite that. I'll multiply through by delta, and I'll divide by Q star. I get delta over delta plus, I'm going to write this in a funny way, delta over delta plus minus dz of log Q V star. Right, because I divided by. And I keep calling it QV because I'm used to that. That's just Q. So I divided by Q, so this dz Q star, where Q star is just the dz of the log. And if I, now this guy has an interpretation, we'll call him gamma. We'll just define it to be that. And this is, again, this is the fractional rate at which Q star declines with height. Right? Fractional rate at which air parcels dry out. So this is fractional. Rate of decline in Q. This also has units of 1 over meters. Right. Q is dimensionless, I've got a dz there. So it's also a length scale, or 1 over a length scale. Right. How high do you have to go for Q to decline by a factor of 1 over E? That's what it is. So that means, finally, and this is kind of what we've been working toward, that I can write the relative humidity in the free troposphere as just a function of two numbers. The length scale over which convection moistens the atmosphere. And this length scale, how do I interpret this? In fact, how do I think about the processes that govern relative humidity? There's two things that are happening, right? Q declines with height at this rate in the environment. But what happens when you have convection? Convection's going up, there's detrayment, it's moistening the environment, but for every unit of mass that goes up, there has to be mass coming down. And so the air in the environment is subsiding. But the air up here is drier than the air down here. And this, in fact, is giving basically that derivative, right? It's the logarithmic derivative of how much drying you're getting as you go up. Right? How is Q decreasing with height? So there's two opposing processes at play. Because when air comes down from here to here, you're bringing drier air down. So there's drying from, this is called subsidence, this air that must sink when convection rises. So subsidence drives the air because there's a gradient in moisture, which this is embodying. But the convection is happening at the same time as moistening it. And so the relative humidity results from a balance between the two. Right? if moistening was very strong, so delta was much bigger than gamma, this would go to 1. Or if the substance drying from this gradient in water vapor was really strong, then delta is much bigger than gamma, and this goes to 0. So you see here this tension between these two processes. And so what we can do now is, let's see, maybe I'll go here. So let's plug in some numbers. How do I want to do this? Numbers. So this gamma is just derivative of Q star. Q star is just given by this. This guy's given by the Clausius-Clapeyron function. And so it's actually not hard to evaluate this derivative. I won't go through it here, but you can go through it on your own or it's in the notes. But you get nice closed form expressions for what gamma is. And if you plug in numbers, it's something like 0.5 inverse kilometers, or 1 over 2 kilometers. So 2 kilometers is the length scale. Sometimes people call this the water vapor scale height, right? So with every 2 kilometers you ascend in the atmosphere, your water vapor constant goes down by 1 over E. Okay. And the detrainment rate, very hard to observe, but in simulations you can cook up. And I don't mean global climate simulations, I mean high-resolution cloud-resolving simulations, where we somewhat trust the convection simulating. So from there, and the simulations are in rough agreement on this, that your fraction of detrainment is something like 1 inverse kilometer. So let's plug those in. And, I mean, the exact number you get is interesting, but the point is just that these numbers are of comparable magnitude, right? And since these guys are positive definite, you know this has to be less than 1, right? Of course it is, right? Maybe it has to be less than 1. And since the numbers are comparable, you're going to get something that's not an order of magnitude smaller than 1. You're going to get some reasonable fraction. And so what do you get? So 1 over 1 plus a half, that's just 2/3, something like 67%. That's a typical value for the Friedrich-Ebersen for the trials. You get it from a combination of length scales, the ratio of length scales. Good, so far the model so far has sort of taught us the dynamics of relative humidity. It's this competition between convective moistening, as embodied by delta, subsidence drying, as embodied in gamma, you plug in numbers, and it gives you the right ballpark. But remember, our interest here is in, how does this change with warming, right? Well, so if you run through this calculation for gamma, I'll just show you the answer because it speaks to this question. It's the latent heat of water times the moist lapse rate that we talked about in the first lecture. So dT dZ, how temperatures are declining with height. RVT squared minus T over RDT. And what you find, if you write down an expression for the moist lapse rate, this is also in the notes, is that it's a function of T and P, but the P dependence is very, very slight. And so that means that, and if you're not dependent on P, then at a given temperature, if you don't care about the pressure, then you don't really know what the surface temperature is. You don't know how high or low down in the atmosphere you are. You just know your temperature, and that's all you care about. And so that is saying that this guy, like many of the quantities that we discussed in the last lecture, is just a function of temperature, the first order. And so when you change the surface temperature, so if I'm going to evaluate gamma at, say, 280 Kelvin in the present-day tropics, and then I warm the surface temperature by 4 Kelvin, if I still look at the 280 Kelvin isotherm, I get the same value again. That's what this is telling us. All right, well, that's just one of the pieces in our formula for RA. What about delta? Delta is much harder to get a handle on. Maybe I will go... So what about delta? We don't know a lot about it. And there haven't really been studies looking at how the profile of detrainment changes with surface temperature. I think it's fair to say that, for the most part, it's unknown. But there is one thing that we do know, right? And that is, the troposphere is this part of the atmosphere where condensation heating from convection and other atmospheric motions balances radiative cooling. And we talked before about the radiative cooling. Let me see if I want to say this. So the top of the troposphere is called the tropopause. And it has a temperature that we find doesn't vary with surface temperature. So the sort of the top of the atmosphere and temperature coordinates isn't changing. Why should that be? Well, this is where convection stops. But convection is going to stop where radiative cooling stops, because those guys are balancing each other. But we saw that the radiative cooling, last time we described this in terms of a flux divergence. So F here was the net upwards radiative flux. And you take a derivative with respect to temperature, where you're using that as a vertical coordinate, and that gives a flux divergence, which tells you how much cooling you're getting layer by layer. And we saw that this guy was a function of temperature only, didn't care about the surface temperature. And so it's going to go to zero at the same tropopause temperature, regardless of TS. So this guy is basically defined by where this goes to zero. This guy doesn't care about the surface temperature, therefore the top of the tropopause doesn't care about the surface temperature. But these clouds go up and they have to stop here. Right? And so when they stop, they kind of eject all their mass into the environment. They're detraining. And so there's always a detrainment peak near the tropopause temperature. And this should also not depend on the surface temperature. So I wouldn't make any claims about what the detrainment profile is going to do elsewhere in the free troposphere, but I know that you'll always get a peak around the same temperature. And so this little sort of little thing that we know about detrainment, plus the fact that gamma is a function of temperature, suggests that relative humidity, just like the flux divergences we talked about last time, as a function of temperature, should be perhaps quite roughly insensitive to surface temperature, TS invariant. And this is consistent with what we see, especially in idealized simulations, but even in global climate model simulations where this gets a bit messier, this is to first order a decent approximation. So what that's telling you is that with climate change, if you look at relative humidity and say pressure coordinates, you get a profile and it looks like it shifts up a little bit. If you look at temperature coordinates, it more or less stays fixed. And so that's the sense in which relative humidity is constant in the free troposphere, is constant with climate change. There's a profile, there's some shape to it, but it basically moves up such that the values stay fixed on a fixed isotope. And so just to circle back to sort of our original question, constant relative humidity means it means different things here and here. Here you can argue that there should be an increase, but it should be small, basically negligible. And here, you have some vertical profile, and as long as you work in temperature coordinates, then this should be changing. And that's the meaning of constant relative humidity with climate change. So with that, I'll stop here and take questions. Thanks. Mitch, and then.
So in the relative humidity formula on the right board,
yes.
Entrainment fell out of the game.
It did fall out of the game.
So do you have, like, what's the, I can see in the math how it falls out, but what's the intuition for why that doesn't matter?
So two answers. One is that it matters if you can, if you want to think about the moisture content of the cloud and how much, say, so the cloud that's rising, it's condensing the moisture started out with, but if there's a lot of mixing, then a lot of that condensed moisture goes towards actually saturating this dry air that's coming in. And so if I were to write down an equation for the amount of condensed moisture inside the cloud, then entrainment is the first order quantity, right? So I didn't write down an equation for the in-cloud moisture. If I did, entrainment will play the role. And I know if I play the same game where I massage things, right, then I'd get a similar equation, but instead of a delta here, it would be an epsilon.
So is the entrainment kind of buried in Q star? Is that what that means?
Ah, good. Yes, in a way. It's buried in the temperature profile as a function of pressure. Because if you have a much more entrainment, right, instead of this sort of pure moist lapse rate that assumes an undiluted parcel, your parcel is getting diluted as it goes up. And so as it moves up, it expands, it cools, it condenses. But then it also mixes, so it doesn't condense as much. And so it's actually a little bit colder than the pure moist adiabatic profile. So you're right. The effects of entrainment are all kind of baked into this and sort of hidden in the way I've calculated it.
Yeah.
My question had to do with your sort of initial cartoon for the convecting region.
Yes.
And the subsiding region, which
yes.
is that, as you said, we abstracted so this single mega plume of convection
yes.
represents all of the convection.
Exactly.
A single subsiding region and
yes.
exchange between the two.
Yes.
But if you were to break your mega plume up into multiple plumes,
yes.
the ratio of this sort of interface to the interior of the plume would change. It would change the interface, it would change presumably the exchange rates. Is there any remotely tractable way, and this, you know, numerically is probably buried in the simulated value of delta, but is there a way to understand how, as you change the number density of plumes across the surface of the ocean, these exchanges change based on the change in the interior cross-section of the plume to its interface
walls.
Yeah,
so it's all buried in here, right? And this is sort of like one of the holy grails slash Achilles heel slash bugaboos of climate sciences. What is, you know, sort of characteristic entrainment rate for tropical convection, and what is the number that we should put into, you know, when you have a climate model, and a climate model is too coarse to simulate convection, what does it do? It uses basically, many of them use a fancy version of this. Basically, both plume models. Maybe you have more than one plume with different entrainment rates. But the point is that if you have plumes of different sizes or plumes that are organized versus plumes that are spread out, the idea is that that would affect this, right? And I haven't said anything about what determines that. You know, I've said, oh, you can run simulations and you get a characteristic value, but certainly the kinds of changes you're talking about will change both the entrainment and the detrainment rate. And then that will feed in and then change the temperature profiles and the cloudiness.
I guess the quick follow-up to that, sorry to be hogging your time,
is
there any way to look at that in a structured way in terms of, say, optimality, that if you had too many small plumes, they would fail to loft enough moisture and enough latent heat into the atmosphere, and so you would violate energy balance, but if you had one super big plume doing all of the ocean's convecting, you're somehow violating a sort of entropy principle that says things tend towards, you know, mixing and disorder. Is there a way to pose it as a balance between those two that gets you in the right ballpark of plume density?
People have thought about that. And yeah, you can't have plumes that are too wide, because actually if they're too wide, they don't rise from fluid dynamical effects. And you're right, if they're too skinny, then they'll just mix too quickly, right? And I mean, in a sort of first order thing you guess is that this length scale is just determined by the length scale of the plume itself. But we've had a hard time nailing that down. So we're actually trying to dig in the details, measure these things, correlate it. with what you see in simulations or observations, there's just a lot of devils in the details. But those ideas definitely are out there. And we're making some progress. Jane, and then tell me your name again, by the way.
June.
June. Yeah.
So does this whole argument that the troposphere depend on clouds not responding to the change of the surface?
So
I guess the whole idea is that if you go to some, if you're not interested in a particular location in Z, but you follow the temperature, then there
right.
you can find this relative
right.
humidity.
Yes. Uh-huh.
But it is actually in a different location, and so are you assuming that the clouds are there just are?
I mean, if you believe this, it's telling you that they will be, right? And that is what you see, right? So there's a so-called fixed anvil temperature hypothesis that says that where you see anvil clouds, like thunderstorm, the tops of thunderstorms, that there's a temperature that those prefer to be at, and that with global warming, those should get higher in Z or in P, which should stay at roughly the same temperature. And there's both observational and simulation evidence for that.
So
the idea is that, in the free troposphere, the clouds do.
So the change in the troposphere depth and temperature coordinates is, there's also the change in clouds. There's
so
a change in the depth of clouds follows it because they.
Yes, that's right. That's right. Because yeah, so if you're in temperature coordinates, right? The picture we had last time is here's your original surface temperature, here's your troposphere temperature, and then you. And so yes, the idea is that there's some like magic temperature here where the anvils are. The surface will get lower. The anvils stay at the same height. So convection will actually traverse a greater depth.
Okay.
Tavio Schneider has a recent paper with a student understanding changes in the Walker circulation from the fact that convection now must traverse a greater depth, basically any way you slice it, temperature, Z, P, or even moist static energy.
My question is also about the clouds. In this simple model, in the cone, there is no liquid water, so there is no...
Yes, I'm assuming that all the liquid water just falls out immediately. And you can elaborate on this and assume that some of that liquid water goes out to the environment.
And also the evaporation.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. But I just give the simplest version where all the condensed water just drops out. But this, this comes from a paper by David Rops in 2014. And if you look in there, the elaboration where you add precipitation efficiency is in there. Max, go ahead.
I just wanted to make a comment that maybe one aspect where this is a little bit simplified is the fact that if there is one variable in the tropical atmosphere that has a wide distribution of values and not just another dispersed distribution, it's relative humidity. So this is considering essentially one relative humidity, and this picture corresponds relatively well to what would be happening in what is called the deep tropics,
that's
or
right.
the ATCZ,
that's right.
where the action of convective clouds is maintaining the air at relatively high not saturated value, but high relative humidity.
That's right.
Now a number of papers that make the argument that the subtropics, which are actually way drier.
Yeah, it can be way drier.
Yeah,
right.
Can be way drier, right? Important for the emission to space and the cooling to
yes,
space.
Yes, that's right.
Actually, might depend very much on the relative humidity, on the transport balance between moisture in mix from the ATCZ, and also some dehydration process that happened because of the overturning of volcanic eddies,
yeah.
which actually like bring.
So this is definitely a super crude picture of the tropical atmosphere, right? So in the real tropics, you have all the rains happening kind of near the equator, and then there's these broad bands of subtropics, 10 to 30 degrees north and south, where there's not as much rain, and there's subsiding air. And this is not a great model for the relative humidity in those regions. I guess the reason we think this is relevant is because this does describe sort of the part of the tropics where the action is. And if we run a model that just does this, that just simulates a patch of tropical atmosphere, that's deep and convecting everywhere, right? The climate sensitivity of that system is very similar to the tropics or the globe as a whole, right? And so the fact that, in the real tropics, you have some super cloudy regions, and you have dry regions, and you have much more radiation coming out of there, It's not clear that to sort of first order that that changes the climate sensitivity from what you might have from a more homogeneous set. I'm sure there are some differences, but in terms of getting a first order estimate, it's not clear.
So,
question.
Can you give me some intuition about where this extra length of gamma comes from?
Yeah, so that's just, so this is literally just telling you how far you have to go before your QV star, your saturation of community, declines by a factor of 1 over one over E. Right?
Right.
But you're asking why does it enter into?
Not why, but I guess how. It doesn't come from that equation, for example, right? That equation has one.
From which? Which equation?
The equation on the top panel. The one in the box, yeah. That has one length scale that's delta, or delta.
No, because you're taking a dz of q and gamma, and so you write this as a, basically, because you're taking a dz, there's another length scale here. And you write this as rh times q star, and then you end up with a dz of q star, and you divide the route by q star, and you end up with a dz of, you end up with that.
Sure, but yeah, no. Maybe we should go off.
Okay. But yeah, it does. I mean, I didn't, right, this.
I mean, that's the equation for two unknowns, right? Q and Q star are both, I mean, both of them are unknown.
No, we assume that T and P are known, and then Q star is a function of T and P. So really what we don't know is Q, and we write Q, so this guy is known, right, via formulas that are on the board. So what we don't know is Q, which we write as a relative humidity times Q star. So then RH is really our unknown. It helps to kind of work through the derivations, and then you see all that. There will be one or two hands up.
One more simple question,
yeah.
Which is just in the vein of asking what is known, what is unknown.
Yeah.
You cite, you know, two single values, you know, for gamma and for delta.
It's typical
but,
values.
Right, but they need not be constant over the profile of the column.
That's
does their variation have an impact one way or the other?
Yes, I mean, so...
I mean, as you said, you have this detrainment at the top where you reach the top of the tropopause.
That's right.
But
so relative humidities go up there, right?
Yeah.
Because the detrainment goes up. So relative humidities approach 1 at the top of the tropopause. As you start from the bottom, in fact, we can see this. This is kind of cool. So what I... So gamma has this term in it. And as you go up in the atmosphere, your temperature goes down. So this goes up. So your gamma is going up, right? So as you move up through the lower troposphere, gamma is going up and relative humidity goes down. And this is a characteristic feature of relative humidity profiles, is they all have kind of this, if I plot, say, temperature coordinates and relative humidity, they all have this kind of C shape. And as you go up, your gamma is getting bigger, so that's why you're decreasing. But then at a certain point, your detrainment starts to take over, and then you increase. So yes, there are vertical variations, and they tell you about the vertical variations in RH. But that's sort of a second order. All right, it's 5:15, so why don't we call it here. Thank you guys for attending. I hope it was useful. Notes are online. I welcome feedback, and thanks a lot.